What I want to talk about, I kind of tentatively called reaching into the past, reaching into the future, because I thought, well, I was kind of looking to create a theme that kind of deals with the theme of virtual future. And right now I'm actually working on a project that kind of addresses what the difference between past and future is. So I thought it's kind of appropriate to pick two things and kind of like explain how they might relate to the past and to the future. So the first thing I'm going to talk about is a project of me and my friend and collaborator Daisy Ginsberg. And the second project, that's going to be like reaching into the past to arrive at a certain future. And then the second thing also relates to a work of mine, but I'm only really briefly going to mention that, but more talk about the research. And that's, in a way, using the present to arrive at a certain future. I hope it's going to make sense. It's probably a bit less academic, sadly so. I wish it were more. So the first project called Growth Assembly, which was created in 2009 at the Royal College of Art in London, had as a starting point this kind of like a fictitious future world without resources. So you have to imagine basically a Western world is deprived of metals and of basic resources, and like a pretty good or like a nice image from that is Soylent Green, you know, the film where at this one point, it's quite long ago actually, I don't know what scene it is, but they're in this house and then somebody brings out metal cutlery and they only have this kind of like half set, which actually now they look at it, looks a lot like the stuff you can get at Tesco now, 85% off the amazing Alessi Ettore Sozzas things, which is coupons on eBay for five quid for 60, and it's really a good deal. And it's actually really beautifully designed, so I'm back in love with postmodernism. And basically you have this world where like these things don't exist anymore, and like everything's kind of quite back to like a pre-industrial society. Being in this design program called Design Interactions, we were wondering how could that be addressed? And at the same time, Daisy met John Hasselhoff from the Hasselhoff Lab at Cambridge University, which looks at plant growth, and they're basically trying to figure out how plants grow, and implicitly also how the growth of plants could be controlled. So basically, through genetic engineering, you could then potentially, in a potential future, kind of address that and kind of design, basically on a computer design a living thing and then put that information into the seed and kind of like end up with something that grows to your design to some extent. That's kind of a part of the project in a way that it might not be like that, but I mean, that's kind of the ambition for some people, especially in the synthetic biology narrative. And here you can see this like cell division and this basic research they're doing. So we ended up with a project we call Growth Assembly, which is basically a collection of seven images that we commissioned with an illustrator called Sean Ab Thomas, who's based in London. And they together formed something that I'm going to talk about in a little while. But this kind of aesthetic choice, and I mean, going back to dance talk, that's actually like consciously using an old aesthetic instead of a new aesthetic, because it's drawing on... and at the time we were kind of doing that somewhat subconsciously actually, it's kind of consciously playing with this paradox of using a technique from very long ago, which was partially like really heavily used and kind of like the most well-known artist from the time is Ernst Haeckel, who's pictured here with his, I think it's his intern on some and travel to some faraway country, because what they were doing basically, and this like probably the book, you know, the Kunstform der Natur, is that they collected natural artifacts, and I'm using artifacts really consciously here. They collected natural artifacts in order to kind of portray them as God's machine creation, right? So nature was depicted as something static that could be collected and cut apart and basically cataloged. And I'm quoting a scholar called Daniel Marcosi here, which wrote a really amazing paper about horse breeding. He was saying nature was static, it had no history, its planets circled in endless cycles around the Earth, its plants and animals were fixed into a determined number of species during the 7 days of creation, and changing nature was well nigh impossible until the day of judgment came. The only task natural philosophers, natural historians, and their illustrators, like Haeckel, are faced with is describing nature from the life. And the only exception there, which is kind of a different topic, but would be breeding, basically. But that's a very interesting thing. It's also kind of like at the advent of industrial revolution, which is kind of like really nicely resonating with the building. I guess that basically you look at these things and kind of think they're fixed and they can be treated like cogs and screws. And you can even go back further if you look at something like Dürer's rhino from 1515, which is basically looks like a tank, like. Definitely looks like a man-made, almost like a man-made armor around an animal. So keep that in mind as a kind of backdrop for the project. And I'm just going to run you through the paintings. So this is like tomato-like. So these are basically, I mean, just to reiterate, they're like genetically modified plants in the future, right? So like by in the time when the what we saw at the beginning, when that's possible, and kind of, I mean, not for everybody, but like an industrial process, somebody could create something like that with like reasonable accuracy. So this is like this tomato-like fruit, and inside it grows these like little nozzles that you can see there, and each makes like maybe 8 of them, I think. Then there's this gourd plant that produces like a liquid inside, but kind of like is a container in itself, and that's the active ingredient of this thing you're going to see. And then there's like a spike fruit that can be peeled from this thing that grows off the branch, and then it's going to be spiked into the gourd to release the liquid. There's a root-like sort of handle that grows upside down to use gravity. Then there's Then there's this like thing that we, in lack of a better name, called flexi cable, which is this creeper plant that creeps up these poles that are specifically set up. And then there's like this little connector, what we call connector fruit, which is what you would use, if you wanted to connect two hoses, you would get in plastic, for example. But it grows inside this little thingy. And then lastly, there's the spaghetti-like cable, which as the more like tubes basically, as they grow longer and longer, the water thing that they sit in gets lower to kind of encourage the growth to the bottom and make it longer and longer. And then if you think again about this future where these things would live in, you have to imagine something like a factory farm of the future. And this is actually an illustration taken from NASA that kind of, I don't know who did it actually, because it's not part of these amazing space colony paintings, but it's definitely meant to be as some sort of kind of like space situation where there's like a self-sustaining hydroculture space station, whatever. I mean, basically, in the 60s, 70s, they were looking a lot at how to maintain life in space through these techniques. Oops. Well. And that's interesting because, like, in a factory farm of the future, you would have, like, a very clear contrast between the nature inside and the nature outside. So basically, you would have these things growing inside and producing something, and on the outside, there would basically be the biosphere. And if you take all these things from the illustrations together, what they make is actually an herbicide dispenser. So the first thing, so it's kind of this handheld thing that basically you put your arm through and then you squeeze this gourd, and out comes something that actually can be used to keep the older, more kind of aggressive nature outside, and in a way it's kind of an externalized defense system of these like weaker, more engineered plants that are actually lacking all these things and are probably going to be quite prone to failure and death ultimately, because they're bred with, or like they're engineered with a specific purpose, and they lack all these like things that make nature so, or make like nature so versatile, because it's kind of like rather a product of evolution than of human intention. Then a curious thing happened, because we made this, and Daisy works in a project called, she's the design fellow in a project called Synthetic Aesthetics, in which I'm a resident, and there's a book coming out soon. And we got invited to go to this conference at Stanford University called the SB 5.0, which is the big synthetic biology meeting. The next one is going to be in London at Imperial next year. So this was last year. And there we found that they had basically taken, I don't want to say our work, but there was like quite a clear connection, because the people who commissioned the conference are quite familiar with just that project. So it had kind of like, in a very strange way, influenced the imagination of the people actually working on these things. And once you started to talk to them, they would say things like, well, this is one of the only images that come to mind when we think about the future of our work. You know, so, because usually, I mean, if you think about some genetic engineering, synthetic biology, a lot of the imagery that's being used is essentially cartoon DNA, right? About which there was actually a hilarious talk there. but they kind of like took our work, but our work in a way, or they at least kind of like did something that resonates with that. But our work reached back into the past to get to that point, which I think in kind of like a context of something like virtual futures is actually quite an interesting thing to think about. Also what's interesting to think about is that it, and that's actually a thought I had just today, that maybe the reason why it resonates with the engineers, because they're all engineers, these people, and not all of them, but in synthetic biology it's quite an engineering-minded discipline. So just because these like old images are so at the advent of engineering, so maybe that's actually a reason for why they resonate. And they actually, if you look at the thing, they're actually emphasized on the engineering part, because they made this kind of like flowery thing actually look like a cog, right? Okay, so that's part one. Part two that I want to talk about is more about space. And actually how in space travel, there was like a very curious phase of how the present was in a way used to reach into the future. So this is the first proper picture taken from space by a modified V-2 missile that was confiscated by the Americans, basically, and launched in December 1946 from White Sands missile range. And basically it was the first man-made object to pierce the, what's it called? No, it is a much nicer name. Kármán, von Kármán line, the Kármán line, yeah, the Kármán line. It's a very nice thing on the BBC website about it. Actually, tonight there's a thing about Voyager on BBC 4, which actually talks about that, because like the next thing is just about to be transcended, if you want, which is like the bow shock that separates the solar system from the interstellar medium. So like these days, like the kind of like next thing is happening. But basically, so they did this, and curiously also, I mean, the Germans put explosives on it, and the first thing the Americans did is that they put a camera in it. So the first proper rocket actually took images, and there was this really strangely kind of almost nostalgic view from space. And then the next thing is that obviously they wanted to put people in space, but they knew very little about locomotion in weightlessness or in like microgravity. So basically, people did not know if people could move without like a frame of reference such as gravity. There's a very fascinating NASA institution called the Langley Research Center in Hampton, Virginia, and who in 1964 published a paper called Man's Self-Locomotion in Lunar Environment. And the need for that, you can easily imagine if you look at Gagarin's Vostok capsule, which you see here just after touchdown, which is basically, I mean, I saw that for the first, like a scale model of that for the first time this year in Moscow. It's a glorified cannonball. It's really amazing that they put somebody in something like this. It's actually quite extraordinary. And then it was not only till 1965 that the first spacewalk was made from a Gemini capsule by astronaut Ed White, and then the Russian cosmonauts followed, I think, weeks later, maybe months later. So this was actually the first proper moment when somebody actually left any sort of frame of reference in relation to the Earth, you know? You see kind of the reverse view here with this kind of like umbilical cord, and I put in another picture because it's, I mean, just look at that. Like, look, imagine being the person who kind of like steps out of that and has this view and kind of like this this feeling. But running up to that, they did a lot of research at this Langley place, and the experiments they did were actually really, really interesting, because basically they had a very large range of, well, I mean, elaborate to kind of crude microgravity simulations. So this is, for example, one where somebody would hang on a tether, like be tethered on these ropes or steel wires. And the basically, if you hung sideways, then it would be zero gravity, and the angle of inclination would be the planet. So if it were, I think 9 degrees is equivalent to the moon, and 20-something degrees would be equivalent to Mars. So basically, they could kind of like have first steps into kind of feeling this. And quoting from that paper, test subjects suspended by cables could perform high jumps, forward and backward flips, handstands and headstands, and an increased ability to perform all sorts of movements which on Earth may come with the risk of bodily harm. So people were actually kind of doing these things a lot. We're going to look at some video later as well. And then there were other things as well with these gimbal systems, and they all look quite funny. And then this one is amazing, not only because the guy looks a bit like a lot of Ghostbusters, but because this is actually exactly what you saw earlier. So they're kind of simulating in this setup the moment of leaving this capsule. And then there's more well-known, more kind of like contemporary things like the nuclear buoyancy tank and the well-loved vomit comet, which is this parabolic flight plane that is being used today quite heavily, actually. Then the thing that I later used for a project, which I like a lot, is the Thomas R. Kane, who was at Stanford University at the time, who was interested in the falling cat phenomenon. So basically, he was interested in whether an astronaut could turn him or herself like a cat in free fall, which then he called the Jones motion. What they did, which I thought was really beautiful, is that they put a trampolinist in a mock spacesuit and had them jump up and down on a trampoline and trying to fall. And he's a mechanical, applied mechanics professor, and they actually proved through experiment and equation that they could. So the falling cat phenomenon applies to people in space as well. And then earlier this year, I sort of like reenacted that in a piece called Camera Futura, which is also kind of an automatic photographic setup, which kind of allows to take a picture of yourself in that future. But I mean, I don't want to talk about that at all. The point is more that, in a way, what they did is actually really interesting, is that these experiments and these papers that were written and these things that were performed in the 60s kind of made the future accessible in a very different way, because they were actually interested in how it feels, right? So like, if you read the paper, it's actually quite nice, because they remarked that the, quote, the effects of lunar gravity on a person's physical capabilities could be described as exhilarating. So they had this like really this is really, I mean, tons of money spent basically to be able to ask somebody how it felt afterwards. And in an art kind of context, I always thought it's almost like a pre-enactment, right? Because, like, I mean, I reenacted something, but in a way they pre-enacted actually this kind of like goal in the future, which was actually to go, or like to be in that situation that was at the time physically unreachable still. There's a black frame now. I don't know what that is. Ah, okay. And then the last thing I want to show actually is there's a couple of interesting videos that actually prove that point and also prove something else that might actually relate to Dan's thing, which I'm actually really curious to talk to him about later. Because you have these things from the 60s and then you have later things from the 70s. And for me, like only like in aesthetic terms alone, they have such a big overlap that it's actually absolutely striking. So this is actually something from the Langley thing where they, I mean, thing, the Langley research facility where they built a circular, don't know what to call it, like a setup to actually see how people could walk in a revolving space station while actually being tethered in the way that you saw in this illustration earlier. I think you have to click it to make it start. I don't think there's sound, actually. Okay. It's actually mainly the last bit that's interesting. And then in 1975, you had Skylab. And Skylab was actually the first proper space station that Nixon called a bungalow in space. So it's actually really huge. And was also designed by, what's his name, the same guy who designed the Lucky Strike logo. So the whole place, the whole thing was basically like a kind of very designed object in space that, as you can see in the illustration, Raymond Lowe. So like the thing was actually really big and had like a lot of volume, if you want. Then there are these amazing videos on YouTube that you can find if you look for Skylab gymnastics or acrobats in space. And so like the three crews who went to Skylab after its almost catastrophic start really used the freedom that they had to do things and to actually move and to like kind of perform all these things that were like pre-enacted before. And what I find is that like the aesthetic the aesthetic overlap between what you just saw, especially the last bit where the guy turns over, and what you're going to see now, for me is absolutely striking.
So. As far as working in zero gravity and moving yourself, it was a delight in comparison to 1G on the surface of the Earth.
Once your eyes see something, then you relate to it, and you say, whatever is above my head is up, whatever is below my feet is down. Doesn't matter whether it's the floor or the ceiling.
Every evening, after dinner and all the work was done, we always had to take a trip or two around the water ring lockers or just go up there and free fly.
We also found that we could have quite a bit of fun doing tricks and stunts and flips and rolls that weren't possible here on Earth.
In space. So I think that's Alan Bean, is like he's the guy who was mainly responsible for that. And then the last thing I want to show to kind of like come back to the, because I opened with the movie image and I'm going to close with the movie image, is kind of, you might guess it, but now combine the first thing you saw and the second thing you saw, especially like how the thing was designed. In the top, I might actually go back once so you can see it better. Like, look at this padding on the inside. And then look at this. Because that's 2001, Stanley Kubrick. And actually, that's actually in between. So you have the experiment that kind of like pre-enacts these movements. And then you have something like this that kind of puts a certain design or like a certain visual narrative in the Dan. And then lastly, you have the actual kind of like enactment of both. And I think that's actually quite an intriguing thing to play with. Okay, so if you actually want to look at all the work I skipped, that's my website. It's basically just my last name. And there's also a bit of writing about these things. So yeah, thank you so much.